Good morning. My name is Reverend Brenda Clark. I'm the pastor of First Congregational Church of Lockport, and we welcome you to our YouTube worship service. We're glad to have you with us. Here are today's announcements. Today is Communion Sunday, so before we get started on worship, make sure you go get a cup of juice and a piece of bread or a cracker so that when we get to that point in the service, you can join us in taking communion together. Bible study is going to start this coming Wednesday, September 9th at 6 p.m. via Zoom. The Zoom link is in our e-blast on Wednesdays. We're going to start with an introduction to the book of Acts and then look at chapter 1 of Acts. We don't have special music this morning because we need more people to share their talents. So if you would like to share a musical gift, singing or playing an instrument, please contact me either by email, phone, or text. We need a new stove. The old stove, we got some money for it, and it's been carried away. We average or expect the new stove, which will also make our kitchen able to be certified as a commercial kitchen. That stove is going to cost around $5,000. We've received a little over $1,000, so if you want to make a contribution to the stove, please send your check to the church and note in the memo that it's for the stove. Christian education this year is going to be meeting via Zoom, so look for information on that for your children to meet. And I will have Zoom office hours this week. They will be on Wednesday and Thursday from 10 a.m. until 1 p.m. Those are the announcements that we have this morning. Let's begin worshiping our God by passing the peace of Christ. As Lee pans the sanctuary, imagine the people that you sit near, the people that you would get up and greet, and pray for them the peace of Christ. The peace of Christ be with you and with all whom you meet this day and every day. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Doris Medema, and I am your lecturer this morning. Welcome to First Congregational Church, an open and affirming congregation where we serve with Christ, love God, and grow in the Spirit. Please join me in the gathering prayer. Praise the Lord. Sing to the Lord a new song in the assembly of the faithful. Let us praise God with dancing, making melody to him with tambourine and lyre. God takes pleasure in his people. God adorns the humble with victory. Let the faithful rejoice in glory. Let them sing for joy with high praise of God in their throats and on their tongues. Let us pray. God of light, keep us from owing anything to anyone except your power to love one another. For when we do, we fulfill the law. Jesus summed up all your commandments in this sentence: love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. Let us love and worship you. Let us love one another with your love. Amen. Let's sing together the opening hymn, "Hear, O My Lord, I See You," stanzas 1, 2, and 3.
Thank you.
Hear the word of God from Exodus chapter 12, verses 1 through 14. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbor in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat of it. Your lamb shall be without blemish, a year old male. You may take it from the sheep or from the goats. You shall keep it until the 14th day of this month. Then the whole assembled congregation of Israel shall slaughter it at twilight. They shall take some of the blood and put it on the two doorposts and the lintels of the house in which they eat it. They shall eat the lamb that same night. They shall eat it roasted over the fire with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. Do not eat any of it raw or boiled in water, but roast it over the fire with its head, legs, and inner organs. You shall let none of it remain until morning. Anything that remains until morning you shall burn. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. And you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord. For I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgments. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague will destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance." God is still speaking. Praise be to God.
Moses has been trying to get Pharaoh to let the Israelite people go. Like that old African-American spiritual, "Let my people go." Multiple times, Moses and Aaron have made the request, and Pharaoh has ignored them, denied them, and denied God. Then 9 plagues happened with horrible results. Several times, Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron to his presence, begging them to stop or reverse the plague, promising that if they did so, he would let the Israelites worship their God on a 3-day journey away from Egypt. Moses would pray to God with Pharaoh's request, and God stopped or reversed the plague, but Pharaoh in turn always changed his mind and said he wouldn't let God's people go. Then a plague came that couldn't be reversed. The plague of the firstborn is revealed to Moses and the Israelites, and they are given specific instructions. Pharaoh is not going to receive advance warning of this plague. He has been given multiple warnings and opportunities and ignored them all. Excuse me. Pharaoh hardened his heart. The Israelites are to choose an unblemished yearling male lamb, and they are to kill it at twilight on the 14th day of the first month. They are to paint the door frames of their homes, the sides and the top, with the blood from the lamb. The painted blood will protect them from experiencing this plague. This first Passover is final proof that God heard the Israelites crying out. After they mark their doorposts with blood, they are told to roast the lamb over a fire with its internal organs and limbs intact. All of it should be eaten, It can't be preserved. They won't take leftovers with them. If you can't eat it all, or you don't have one, you share with your neighbor, and you burn what you can't eat. You are to be dressed in a specific way when you eat it. Your loins are to be girded. Because they wore tunics, what this meant is they would fasten a girdle around their waists and then tuck the tunic inside of the girdle so that they could make a quick getaway. Their legs wouldn't get wrapped up in the tunic. That's what it means to gird your loins. Their sandals were to be on their feet. They were to have their staff in their hand, and they were to eat in a hurry. This first Passover is the end of their slavery in Egypt, and they will have to leave quickly. From this first Passover on, they will celebrate every year to remind them of how God has freed them. Now, if you've ever experienced a Seder, the Passover dinner, you know it's filled with ritual and memory. Lamb is eaten, unleavened matzah bread is eaten, parsley dipped in salt water, they consume that. They drink four different cups of wine at various times, one cup at a time, throughout the meal. And each cup has a different meaning. When Jesus was in the upper room with his disciples on the last evening of his life, he shared that Passover meal with them. Together, they were remembering how God freed them from slavery. It was matzah bread that Jesus prayed over and broke. The prayer he said over the bread went something like this: Blessed are you, Adonai, our God, sovereign of all, who brings forth bread from the earth. The four cups of wine that you drink during the Seder have these meanings. The first cup is the cup of sanctification, to be made holy. The second cup is praise to God for saving them from bondage. The third cup is redemption. God redeems with outstretched arms and great judgments. And the fourth cup is the cup of acceptance and anticipation. God has accepted us, and together we anticipate the great feast we will share when we get to the promised land. The final cup is the cup that the disciples drank, and Jesus did not drink it. Matthew tells us that he said, I will not drink of this cup again until God's kingdom is completed. So whenever we take communion, we are in a way remembering the Passover. We remember the last Passover Jesus ate and infused with new meaning and new memories. Christians celebrate communion, Eucharist, or the Lord's Supper more often than our Jewish sisters and brothers celebrate the Passover. We don't partake of the entire Seder dinner when we take communion, but we remember how God's love and care saves us from ourselves. We remember how God promises us new life in Christ and a fulfillment of God's kingdom, where we will all share in the great banquet feast together. Jesus is delivering us from the world as it is now and promises the power through the Holy Spirit to live right here, right now, in God's kingdom as God intended us to live always and as God will have us live forever. We celebrate God's gift of Christ, who teaches us holiness and sends the Holy Spirit to help us in our sanctification process that will take the rest of our lives. We praise God for the ability to overcome and the freedom that overcoming suffering and hardship and evil brings. We celebrate God's redemption of our lives to make us more like Christ every day and make us better with each day that passes, better than we were yesterday. We celebrate God's acceptance of us and our anticipation of the day when we will be together and the great feast we will have with God, Jesus, and all the believers at the completion of God's kingdom. This is what communion means to us. This is how Jesus transformed Passover, so we too may be transformed in the image of Jesus Christ, who is our Savior, our Deliverer, and our Redeemer. Let it be so. Amen. Here are our prayer joys and concerns for today. Jack and Carol P. celebrated their 47th wedding anniversary on September 1st. We send them warm congratulations on this special day. Gracious God, we thank you for bringing Carol and Jack together. We thank you that they have loved each other and lived together through thick and thin, for richer and poorer, in sickness and in health. We pray that you will continue to bless their marriage. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayer. Carol P. met her second cousin, Cheryl H., through Cheryl's genealogy search, and they've been phoning one another and were even able to meet on Carol's deck this past week because Cheryl lives so close. Holy One, we thank you for bringing together relatives who did not know each other before. We thank you that they're getting to know each other and that they are getting to love one another. Bless their relationship as it continues to grow. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. And Sandy P's friend from high school, Judy S., has some health problems. God of healing, we pray for Judy and her health problems, that you would guide the medical people as they seek to diagnose and seek to treat her, and that you would heal her body. Help Sandy be a good friend to her, as we know she will be. Bless them both through this time. Thank you, God, for hearing our prayers. Let's continue with prayers of the people. Gracious God, who hears our prayers, who strengthens hearts, though we do our best to harden them, you bless over and over. Be with those who suffer and bring them peace. Be with those who hunger and nourish them as only you can. Be with those who weep and wipe away their tears. Be with those who rejoice and share their joy. Be with us all, however we are this day, and help us to be your hands and heart, loving others as we love ourselves and you. We lift up Mark's Uncle Joe as he is still healing. We lift up Jill's friends, Val and Diana, Janet K., Tom T.'s friend Linda L., Sharon B. and her brother Mel D., Jeannie W. and Joan R., Mindy S.'s uncle and Reverend Bob Stout, who are both under hospice care, Carol P. and her friend Pat G., and her other friend, Pat L. We lift up Doris and Jack's daughter, Diana, who is facing her second cataract surgery this coming Wednesday. Thank you, God, for knowing what each one of them needs before we even ask. Thank you for loving them and for giving them what they need when they need it. Help us be part of whatever it is, whether it's healing or homegoing or patience. Help us be part of that process for each of them. And may we be free from danger and fear. May we be healthy and dwell in peace. May all beings be free from danger and fear. And may all beings be healthy and dwell in peace. And now hear us as we say together the prayer Jesus taught his disciples when he said, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen."
Now is the time we prepare our offerings to give to God. God gives to us continually. In each breath, we receive God's Spirit, responding to God's generosity. Let us give to God in thanksgiving. You may make donations at our website or by mailing them to the church.
Let us dedicate our offerings together. Let us pray. We dedicate to you, generous God, our lives. Receive these offerings as a sign of our gratitude and commitment. Amen. Please join me as we remember our story together. Jesus sets the table where we dine today. Jesus' welcome extends to all of humanity, people of all ages, of all genders, of all cultures, and of all economic conditions are welcome here. No one can earn a place at this meal. We come of our own choice. You need only desire a deeper relationship with the risen Christ. We bring our hopes and our history. We bring our deliberations and our doubts. We come as our whole selves. Through your Holy Spirit, you breathe through us, gathering us as a church. Thank you for continuing to bring us together that we may celebrate you. On the night before Jesus died, he was in an upper room with his disciples, and they shared the Passover meal together. As part of that meal, he took bread. He gave thanks for it and broke it, saying, "This is my body for you. Take it, eat it, and whenever you do, remember me." The bread of life for you. In the same way, Jesus took the cup. He blessed it and said, "This cup is the new covenant or promise which is found in my blood for the redemption of you, for the deliverance of you from your sins. Take it, drink it, and whenever you do, remember me. The cup of joy for you. Let us give thanks for this feast we have shared together. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for this meal and for all of the ways you nourish us. Grow in us that we may nourish others. Sustain us as we press toward the goal of your call in Christ Jesus. Amen. Now let's sing together, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Thank you. Receive the blessing for this week. Creator and Redeemer, send us into the world to meet all creation with the spirit of hope and justice, remembering this congregation exists to change the world with God's love. And now let's close our worship by singing the response, God is so good.